In order to quantify the amount of spatial autocorrelation in a variable x, we are going to use Moran's I statistic. Moran is the name of the gentleman who discovered the statistic in the earlier part of the 1900s. As you can see, Moran's I is formulated very similarly to a correlation statistic. The major difference between Moran's I and just simple, say, Pearson's correlation is that with Moran's I, we only have one random variable, the x variable. And in correlation, we had an x and a y. So the cross product terms in correlation were xi minus x bar and then yi minus y bar. We had two variables, and we wanted to see if the two variables were higher at the same time and lower at the same time. In this case, what we're looking for in the cross product is whether two locations of x are high at the same time or low at the same time. And specifically, we want to know whether these two locations are high or low together when they are closer together in space. So if I and j are close together in space, and they both, say, are above the mean, then our cross product term is going to be positive. If they're both below the mean, then our cross product term will be positive. But if I is above the mean, and say j, and j is close to I in space, but if j is below the mean, then we're going to have negative cross product terms. Or vice versa, if xi is low and xj is high. In all of these cases, we're only going to consider pairs of locations, I and j, that are neighboring one another. And we're going to use this w as a measure of spatial proximity between I and j. So w sub ij is some kind of weight that tells us how close together locations I and j are. On the denominator of the equation, we just have the sum of squares. So this is a total measure of, say, variance in the x variable. And over here to the left, this first part of the fraction is just n, the sample size, divided by the sum of all the weights. So we're going to sum up over the entire weight matrix. And we're just going to use this to standardize the statistic into a range between minus 1 and plus 1. Because if we didn't have this first part, and if we didn't have this bottom part, we would just have the sum of cross products, which could be really high or could be really low, but it's going to be dependent on the scale of measurement used in x. By dividing by the total variation in x and by controlling by this term over here, we take the sum of the cross products and put it into a range between minus 1 and plus 1.